Sons, left with two daughters-in-law, and she loved dear like her very own daughters. And they had to determine where we're going from here. One daughter went back to her people, to her gods, and another daughter claimed to Ruth, and made Ruth God her God. And we determined that that was the God of Israel. As we go forward today, in our lesson, we pick it up in Ruth, the second chapter. And we need to look at some things here regarding our goodness and the power we need. So if we look at Ruth, the second chapter, we'll see here by our lesson today, and as we also, let's quickly turn to the third chapter of Ruth. We want to see that nothing happens by accident when is involving God's people. Nothing happens by circumstance. It's there's a plan behind it. God is behind everything. You look behind, pull the curtains, you see all. I see God's hand was in this. No matter how bad the situation looked, or how it turned out, peculiar, I can see God was in this. Now here's what, we're kind of fast-forwarding in our lesson right away, but let's look at the third chapter, verse 7 through verse 9. 7 through verse 11. Someone read that. We're going to see if we can put all this puzzle in.
And when Boaz was beaten and drunk, and his heart was merry, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of corn, and she came softly and uncovered his feet and laid her down. And it came to pass at midnight, the man was afraid, and turned himself, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. And he said, "Who art thou?" And she answered, "I am Ruth thy handmaid. spread therefore thy skirt over thine handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman. And he said, blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast shown more kindness in the latter end than at the beginning, inasmuch as thou followest not young men, whether poor or rich. And now, my daughter, fear not. I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman.
Okay, and this is the life of Ruth. She clung to Naomi, we saw last week, and we also have determined today that Ruth is a woman, a young girl of integrity. If she had her choices, she didn't care whether she wasn't after money, even though she was in a very bad economic state. She was not impressed with the rich or the poor or the good looking. She was a very down-to-earth young woman in a very bad circumstance. So what I'm saying today is that in all of the circumstances, behind the scene, what we're going through, what we're facing, as a child of God, and she said here, kinsman. She's a Moabite, and she's calling Moab, who is a Hebrew, her kinfolk. Ah, so we'll pick that up maybe later on today. Obed, her kinfolk. So we'll see how she kind of, how you equate that. But whatever is going on in the life of a believer, behind the scenes, if you pull the curtain back, you'll find God working out a plan. His fingerprints is on it sometime. Whoa. So let's see about Ruth, her situation. Now that she is, she says, I'm your kinsman, verse 9. Kinsman means we're very so close. And her position is that I've been adopted into the family. That's her reality. I'm adopted into your family. So don't try no funny stuff. Although Boaz has a lesson to teach every single man looking for a single girl, a virtuous single girl. If you follow Boaz's plan, you probably get you. I'll charge y'all a cup of coffee and donut for that price. Because I can remember some 35, 6 something years ago, I saw a little girl with long hair, kind of cute. And I showed her my resources. I bought her a hamper. She's been around ever since. She wouldn't go for a hamburger now. I took advantage of the day, the circumstances. Okay, so here we go. And I lessened the day. All right, so sharing God's goodness is the first point we want to learn today. Is if you have it, it's your responsibility to share God's goodness. And Ruth determined, as I said, she's a part of God's family, kinsman within a redeemer. And how is Jesus our kinsman redeemer? He's our kinsman because he is Messiah. He is Messiah. That's the first part you have with him, is that you are in the bloodline. Your kinsmen. And that's why Matthew 1 and 5 is so important for anybody, any New Testament believer to understand. Read that and get the revelation that of Obed. And who was Obed's mom again? Matthew 1 and 5. Quick.
Ruth,
okay. And so Ruth is a Moabite. We're talking about a Hebrew lineage. I'm part of the family. It's listed in the word. Moabite, Ruth, a Moabite, beget Obed, who beget Jesse, who was the father of David, who was the lineage that Jesus comes from. So, here we have to say that we are adopted into the family of Jesus. He's the Messiah. That's the kinsman. K-I-N-S. That's our kinship rights. We have kinship rights. We have family rights. And not only do we have family rights, but we have redemption rights. So Ruth is telling Obed, I'm a kinsman, and I have redemption. I have been purchased for it. I've been brought, B-R-O-E, paid for to have this position. she had that revelation way back then. We got New Testament believers still struggling. I just don't see how I'm entitled to it. Oh, but I'll be that good. Is it really? I just don't see. Even the prodigal son saw that. I got a father, he's got resources. I'm going back, no matter how I live, I'm going back to a father with the resources, and I'm going to live for him. Woo! That's still hard. It was hard for his brother to see that, who lived in the house every day. So as soon as we as New Testament believers get a glimpse, kinship and redemption rights, I got rights in the family, I've been bought, it's all been paid for, I'm coming to enjoy my benefits. Yeah. All right, here we go again.
The prodigal son kind of does kind of like we do sometimes. He went in there saying, even though it's my father's house, it's got to be better than living out here with the pigs, but I'm willing to live as a servant and all. And his father had to show him through that love that he was still here, the rights of a son.
Praise God. So, Ruth, very good. Ruth 2 and 8, let's start over there. Let's see what we're going to find out today. Ruth 2 and 8. She said, someone read if you will, the word says.
Then said Boaz unto Ruth, hearest thou not, my daughter? Go not to glean in another field, neither go from him, but abide here fast by my maiden.
Okay. Then said Boaz unto Ruth, hearest thou not? And when he says, hearest thou not, he's saying this, please listen to me very carefully. If you don't do anything, listen to this. My daughter, go not to glean in another field. In other words, don't go nowhere else, neither go from hence, but abide here fast by my maidens. Now, Boaz is, I'm going to say, even as I've been studying the Bible through the years, I'm going to say Boaz is being a typical male.
I know where you're going with this.
You know, it's got some testosterone in his bones. So, and he sees Ruth, who don't look too bad, but she's in a bad situation. And Boaz says, I'm the boss. All this is mine. I got all the resources. And I'm coming down, actually, not to see a beautiful woman today, but I'm actually coming down to see how my business is going. That's why he's coming around to see how things is going. And he's, because the way that the deal worked was that the reapers were his male employees, so like his male employees who were to go and do the heavy lifting and chop down the plants. And the gleaners was to kind of come back behind them from a distance and pick up the residue. And they could have that because it was a law in Leviticus, I believe it's in Leviticus 19, 9 and 10, that says that you got all these resources and you should remember who?
The poor.
As Jesus said, as Paul said, and Jesus said that you should remember the poor. Jesus says, I'm anointed to preach, and here's how you can tell. I'm preaching to who? The poor. The poor has the gospel to preach to them. And somewhere the Bible tells us, do not despise the who? The poor. Do not despise them. Make provisions for them. Help them out with what you're blessed with. So this is something going all the way back to Leviticus 19 and 9. Anybody ever get their name on this here?
When you reap the harvest of your land, thou shalt not wholly reap the corners of thy field, neither shalt thou gather the gleanings of thy harvest. And thou shalt not glean thy vineyard, neither shalt thou gather every grape of thy vineyard. Thou shalt leave them for the poor and the stranger. I am the Lord your God.
So leave them for the poor and the stranger. Leave that residue for the poor and the stranger. So Ruth's position was to, and she was taking that position when Boaz met her, was to be back there and just get the very bit of leftovers, just to take back. You can't even eat it while you're picking it up. You gotta wait till you get back home and eat it. Don't be out there in the field coming to eat the leftovers, the rejected ones. You gather them up, but you take them back to your house, and then you can have your dinner. If you come here poor, hungry, you still can't eat while you're doing all this. You do it when you get back to your place. You just come here to do what you gotta do. And that's what Ruth was doing. She was just there, just barely making it. So Boaz, being a businessman, come to see what his harvest looked like. And it's kind of like me back in the day, high school days, I always looked over to see what the field was. They don't hear me, Roach. Always checked out the field, see what it was like. And here comes and he got all about the wheat. And he spotted something. Who was that? Where'd that come from? Who was that? Stranger. Let's see. Maybe I'm, let's see it. I think it says so in verse 9.
Verse 9 of
our list. Finish up verse 8. So do not glean, don't go nowhere else, is what he's telling you. He has a twofold purpose. Don't go nowhere else. Abide fast by my maintenance. In other words, I'm going to even get you a more secure spot. Get on up there close to these people. Verse 9.
Let thine eyes be on the field
where
thou art. That they do reap, and go thou after them. Have I not charged the young men that they shall not touch thee? And when thou art athirst, go into the vessels and drink of that which the young men have drawn.
That's right. So all of a sudden you are a stranger. And I think, let's see really her position. Fast to Ephesians, I think the second chapter. Her status. Second chapter of Ephesians 2, 11 and 12.
Wherefore, remember that ye being in times past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands. That at time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers of the covenant of promise.
From the covenant.
From the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in this world.
And that's how she was. She was a stranger from the covenant of Israel, the commonwealth of Israel, and she had no place in the covenant. This is her position. And having no hope and without God in the world. And that's how Boaz saw her, but I'm sure that Naomi and the sons had instilled upon them, at least this is what the covenant of Israel is about. And she says, and the least you can do is go and glean, get the residue from the field. You are a stranger, and that's the least. But Naomi and Ruth had to see further than that to make the adventure. And when she showed up there to glean, like I said, God's hand is working, just barely making it. Here comes this old Boaz, rich man, with all the resources, and says, now I'm going to give you favor. Now, that's how it works. You step out on faith, and favor shows up. And grace is real close to working with faith. But in the natural, my position is, my circumstance is very, very bad. And he says to her, hang close to my maidens, drink from over here. These guys have already gathered the heavy water. If I didn't really regard you, if I wasn't giving you favor, you have to go lift your own heavy water and drink it yourself. After all, you are a stranger. You have no part with this here. Care less than that. But you all have got a mind as well. That's what it is. All right. Well, I got it. Okay, back to the to us.
You know, I think the faith that Ruth had was a testament of her husband, because she came in as a Moabite woman, and evidently in the home, you know, and it's the man's job to teach the word to the rest of the family. He had gotten that word so into her that she had faith. And that was the difference between her and her sister, that even when her mother-in-law's faith may have been waning and said, y'all go back, she had enough of that word, she had enough understanding of what this covenant was, that she wasn't going to waver.
I agree. So she ventures out to help Naomi, who's too old to do this. So she ventures out and starts just getting what she's, the minimum that she's entitled to. But she gets favor with that step of faith. And the favor of grace is closing. And then she fell on her face, verse 10, bowed herself to the ground and said unto him, why have I found grace in thine eyes, that thou shouldest take knowledge of me, seeing I am a stranger? Let's see what Boaz has to say. Why are you asking me out? I'm right now. Just kidding, he said. Go ahead. Go ahead.
And Boaz answered and said unto her, it hath fully been shown me all that thou hast done unto thy mother-in-law since the death of thy husband, and how thou hast left thy father and thy mother and the land of thy nativity, and art come into a people which thou knewest not
heretofore. So Boaz says he knows her situation, that this lady, this family has come back into the camp, and it's been revealed to me, it's been shown to me, it's you're the talk of the camp, you're the talk of the community. How you have really helped your mother-in-law. Now, here's the tip number one to all the brothers. Always operate with integrity and always be straight. When you're talking to a single woman, always operate with integrity and always be straight. That's what Boaz was doing. But he also had tea working. That old natural appeal to the opposite sex. Since the death of thine husband, aha, I know you're not married. And how thou hast left thy father and thy mother. See, I know how you have, I know you, young lady, are not dealing with those false gods. Tip number two. Don't mess with a woman who is not what? Saved. Even though T is working, don't mess with a woman that is not saved. Don't even help them out. Woo.
This
is the devil I got to find you in there.
I got an addendum to put on.
Okay.
And when she is saved, it is fully revealed, it's obvious.
It's
been fully shown unto me, all you've done.
Yes. And the land of thy nativity. You come into a people which I know is not. I know it's hard for you. You don't know our culture. You don't know how we operate over here. I know you're having difficult times. So he's genuinely wants to be of help. We all on the same page?
Yeah.
Before we go into the next verse, wait a minute, you better turn to Psalms 36 and 7. Give us a moment to speak. All right, anybody got that?
How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God. Therefore, the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wing.
Okay. Now, here it is. You're a stranger. You don't know nothing about what's going on over here. These other men could take advantage of you. Little poor girl. You don't even have no husband to protect you. Unless she got some old lady to help you out. These other men can really do you in. Here's here, she has stepped out on faith into a circumstance she's not familiar with. She just barely knows that I'm supposed to do this and stay back away from everybody else. But as a mother, I can relate to like a, if you have animals and have had pets who have had, like I say, dogs who have had puppies, or if you've been on the farm, you've seen that animals really naturally protect their offspring. And here, for example, the eagle, so I can use that as a reference, how the eagle, I believe somewhere you might hear, under the shadow of thy wings, anyone ever hear that? Under the shadow of thy wings, I think it's in Psalms 91. Psalms 91. You know, the wing is my protection. It gives me shadow from the heat, all like that. This is what Ruth is finding herself is that even though I'm stepping out here in a dangerous situation and don't know nothing about this turf out here, there is an invisible God giving me the shadow of protection under his wing. And so that's what she knows, that I got this protection, although it's not visible, but I do have this cover. Speaking of cover, every married woman, Sister Hill, has a what?
Cover.
Which is her husband. And he's supposed to, he gives us advice, protection, and all the nine years. Someone knock on the door to come visit. It should not be the woman to come answer the door. But the dude said, honey, go answer it. Coward. See who that is. You know. 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night time. Who is that? I don't know. So see, you'll go see who that is. It's 9, 11 o'clock at night. We need something in the house, and we got to get down to the store before it closes. There's a late opening store. Sister girl, go right out there and get that. I'll wait right here. We'll finish watching the game when we get back. What's wrong with that picture? So the husband provides her that type of protection, and God gives that to all of us. Under the shadow of his wings are we protected, we can trust. So this is where we come in verse 12. Someone read that if you would, please.
The Lord recompense thy work, and the full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust.
Amen. You have progressed in faith in the Hebrew culture and doctrine that you know about the covenant. You have come to trust in the Lord. That's what he can tell you. You have come to trust in, you have become, you're growing in the Lord. So, if I was a single man, that would be the type of woman I'm looking for. I mean, it might catch my eye. Good looking. Trusting. Notice I said good looking. Just wired. Then I come to find out, do you trust the Lord? And Boaz is gaining confidence. Trusting the Lord. And you've come to trust the Lord.
Tip number one for women, if you're virtuous, you will be recompensed.
If you are virtuous, the Lord is behind the curtains, working the circle, the scene, working the deal. He's got his hands in there, so that the path does cross some kind of way. So, all right. Boaz says, I see you, who trusts in the Lord. Not just any God, but the God of who? Israel. Even though you're Moabite, it's quite obvious. You are the uncircumcised. And you got an attitude about you, according to Ephesians 2 and 11. Right. Peter had an attitude about you. Weird folks, they don't even know how to eat. I don't sit down with Peter, until he was behind the scenes, then he sat down with him and ate the pig feet. Not in public, he wouldn't do it. Verse 13. All right. And so she responds back with what?
This let me find favor in thy sight, my Lord. For that thou hast comforted me, and for that thou hast spoken friendly unto thy handmaid, though I be not like unto one of thy handmaids.
That's right. Yeah. This is the telephone talk. Yeah. Oh, you're a nice, friendly guy. Oh, you're so nice. Y'all agree with that? You help me out. Yeah. I think I remember Brother McClellan's testimony that he helped Sister Denise out with a flat tire. Is that right, Brother McClellan? All those other cars passing by. Brother McClellan. What's your name? What's wrong? Oh, you got a flat. Well, yeah, I could change that flat. No problem. Here, you stand to the side. Yeah. Is the Lord lining stuff up? Then you got to know each other, talking on the phone. Oh, you're friendly. Yeah, I'll go out to him. Spoken friendly unto me. Huh? I'm not out of here. This community, this culture. So, that's how the Lord even works in culture.
Even though I realized you didn't have to do it.
You didn't have to. You didn't have to help me with that flag. I didn't have to buy her that hammer. There's a whole bunch of other girls. Like I said, every day I went out and looked at the car. Looked over the field. See what was going on. Is that right, Brother John? Okay. Brothers won't admit it, but that's how we are. I'm the only one brave enough to see it. We looked at the field every day and then we were singing to see what the clock was. Okay. All right. Verse 14. What did Boaz do?
Boaz said unto her, at mealtime, come thou hither.
Man, let me take you out to lunch.
And dip thy morsel in the vinegar. And she sat beside the reapers. Ah. And she reached her parched corn. And she did eat and was spiced.
And left. That's key. And left. That's key. But old Boaz, being who he was and the way he was wired, let's go to lunch. Tell you what. I want you to eat some of this good food. Hang with me. Don't eat the stuff that you came here to deal with, the rejected food. Come over here. At mealtime, come hither and eat of the bread and dip thy morsel in the vinegar. And in other words, come up here to where we are and sit right here with us and eat with us. I know that stuff is dry out there, but guess what? Come dip it over here and see what I mean. So the brother says, after the telephone conversation, let's go to lunch and what's a nice restaurant? We're in Greenland, not Greenland, but the other Italian place on the 21st. Olive Garden. Maybe even higher class than that. Yeah. Well, if we said let's go to the greasy spoon over here on 46th Street, then that's the hamburgers over there. Yeah, it'll fill you up, you know, let's go over there. That's, this guy ain't about for real.
It's a cheapskate.
Yeah, cheapskate. So Boaz says, come on up here and eat the good stuff. Treat you to a good lunch. She sat beside the who? The reapers. The guys who was gathering up the good food. She sat down with them. But she has raised, Boaz has raised her status up in front of everybody.
Wow.
And he reached her, what?
Parched
corn. And she did what? Eat. And will suffice. And she decided to stay the night.
Chase was on.
No, you don't hang around sisters for breakfast. You get up and you leave. Because he said earlier that nothing impressed her about a man. His resources, his good looks, and all of that. She wasn't in there. She got up. Yeah. Now, a conniving woman would say, I tell you what, why don't you invite me back for tomorrow? Why don't I just stay over there and stay with you? We get breakfast and perhaps lunch too. But no, she's a virtuous woman and she got up and you were good. Cecile, is this a New Testament lesson? Can this be taught?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
I mean, how does a single woman handle herself? How does a single man handle himself? Both in the Lord. Hormones just a rage. So hormones have a purpose because they attract the opposite sex. And that's how we populate and give God and the people on the earth to do his work. But if the hormones are out of whack and we are going by no standards or anything, we just got it. It's just all over. Sister Candace says sin goes well. So God has his standards of how to operate. Single woman, virtuous woman, get up and leave. Go back to your house.
Because of the spirit that was in her, she knew the boundaries.
The boundaries. So she got up and she left. Yes, sir, brother.
Was she a country love for Sister Mary? No, real country love. I mean, a real country love. Everybody in the country. It's different than outside. Country love, she had a really good country love.
Okay. So she had a real. I didn't hear my voice just here for this.
She said he had a country love for Naomi.
Yes.
She's really looking out for her.
She's really looking out for Naomi. That's right. Her interest was taking care of mom-in-law. That was her chief concern, was taking care of mom. Economic situation was very, very bad. Very, very bad. You know, some folks try to improve that economic situation. We saw a movie last night that we had. Trying to improve, well, they accused single women of trying to improve their economic situation by going to college and just to do what? To find a husband. It was back in the 70s too. They went to college just to find a husband on the rise. And but Ruth was not like that. She was just trying to take care of mom. She was not out looking for a husband.
Not only that, but I think that she was really, really humble because we've already established that she wasn't looking for a husband or anything like that. But you know, sometimes when we get to be Christians and you hear a little bit of the word, you kind of feel like you're entitled, that you ought to bless me because I'm a Christian or like that. And that wasn't the attitude that she had to a boy. She says, you didn't have to do this. You know, you're blessing me. I realize that you're blessing me, even though I'm not born a Jew. Mm-hmm. That you're still blessing me, and that's an honor.
Yeah. Okay. So she got up and left. Verse 15. When she was risen up to glean, now when she came back to, she went back out to the field to glean. Boaz. Now I think Boaz is pretty sharp because he's eliminating this competition. I know y'all see all the spiritual stuff, but I think Boaz is in the natural. He's eliminating this competition.
He was calculating.
Oh, okay.
He had something up his sleeve.
He said, don't you mess with him. In other words, so when she was risen up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, let her what? Glean even among the good stuff. And reproach her what? Don't you give her a hard time.
Don't make her feel sad or ashamed or lonely.
That's right. In other words, he's raising up her status. She's entitled to good not the residue, the small fruit, or what have you. She's entitled to the very best of the best that's out there.
Oh, boy.
Now we can fast forward to 2011 and determine, am I entitled to the very best of the best that's out here? Sit with the best people in the restaurant. Look into the very best neighborhoods, the ones they call gated communities. Open house. Should I walk into it with my head down, or should I just say, well, you know, just looking? Should I walk into the best department store and they say, may I help you? Just looking. Or should I look like, no, I intend, I could, I might buy somebody. Some folks have a very low self-esteem, inferiority complex about themselves when the word has already told them that they'll step up to the front of it. Walk on the high places over there and look around. If we're going to house hunting, so we'll look over here on, I think we can even look past, we can look into the gated community. I mean, by that, you got to push your code in and let the gate open up for you to get in there. If you forget your code, you can't come home. There are some places like that around here. All right. So she says, well, you have done me great. And verse 16, and let fall also some other. This is what he says. He's giving favor, throwing in grace. And let also some of the handfuls of purpose. Let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her and leave them. In other words, drop some of the good stuff. Let her pick it up. That she may glean them, and don't you rebuke her for coming away with some of that good porter, big old porter peaches. Not the ones that fell on the ground and all the blue stuff. Nah, she got, give her the best of the best. Let her get some of that. Think Boaz is doing his little man thing again in here?
But he was ordered of the Lord.
It was ordered of the Lord.
Because she had a humble spirit. And she was sold out completely to him, and she was operating in faith. And when you said earlier, when there comes, when there's faith, there's favor.
There's faith. Grace is right there close by. Okay. Verse 17.
So she gleaned in the field until evening, and beat out that she had gleaned. And it was about an ephah of barley.
Quite good. Go ahead and read verse 18.
And she took it up and went into the city. And her mother-in-law saw that she had gleaned. And she brought forth and gave to her that she had reserved after she was sufficed.
Okay. So she purposely gave it to the mother-in-law and said, we'll forward. And the story goes on. I think we'll pick it up next week. Boaz and Ruth, but let's turn real quick to Ephesians, the second chapter. And here are New Testament realities, chapter 2, verse 19. We're going to verse 18. For though but through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore, you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens.